You're now listening to From the Jump, where we keep the convo going with the latest and greatest in hip-hop. With your hosts, Mr. White and Syllable. They tell it like it is.
From the Jump.
Yeah, man, I appreciate you. I appreciate you, Mike and I. It's been a hot minute since I freestyled with you at 501 Studios at one of those shows. Hanging out outside. But I'm glad to see that you're here right now, man. How you holding up? Are you in San Francisco or are you in LA?
I'm down in LA right now.
That's dope.
Yeah.
That's dope. I'm working with Malik Youssef over in LA as well. I've been behind the scenes on the new Donda album, so I've been seeing that getting made. And
man, congratulations on that.
I appreciate that. Yeah, how I first got started was definitely with that project, Glowed, working with Midlord when he was living in Austin, Texas here, and he helped produce my first mixtape that I took to Rock the Bells and was just had a backpack, handing out that shit to people left and right, trying to sell it for like $5. And
as you should.
Yeah, yeah, and that's the grind. I appreciate you coming to interview with us on From the Jump. This is a hip-hop podcast where we talk about anything and everything that relates to hip-hop, pop culture, hip-hop as a genre versus hip-hop as a music. Are prisons financing record labels to promote stereotypical behavior in hip-hop to fill up prisons, or is it really about freedom of expression?
Definitely want to touch on is just kind of like your come up story. It might have been some time since, you know, you jumped in the game, but to us, we definitely want to let our audience know, like, you know, how was it for you when you initially got into hip hop? What made you fall in love with hip hop and start this journey?
I think it was just kid. I might have been maybe in the fourth or fifth grade, and we kind of played hooky from elementary just for like an hour. I went over to his house.
Okay.
And he started playing some records, and he said, these are the records that my mama won't let me play.
Mm.
And I think he had grabbed a Blowfly record.
Okay.
And grabbed like a Dolomite record or something.
Mm.
And we're listening to that. Blowfly, I think it might have been Rap Dirty or something. Might have been a little older, I don't remember. But it was like Rap Dirty. And then that cool little summer when Sugar Hill dropped, you know, Rapper's Delight.
Yeah.
And I was starting to buy records. And then I think it was mandatory busing. I had to get bused in the sixth grade, right? So I would always ride on the back of the bus, and every day or every other day going to school, to pass the time, I started making little raps. So kids started to anticipate that. And after a while, the bus driver would turn the radio down just so they could hear whatever rap I made for the day. I was maybe in the sixth grade, around 12 years old. And then, you know, you're buying records and stuff. And I remember buying a Fatback record because I liked them. Looking for that good stuff. Tighten up on your backstroke. Yeah, it was called Backstroke. But on the flip side of that single, I had a song called, I forgot what it's called, but it was a rapper on it named King Tim the Third.
Okay.
And King Tim the Third, you know, he's some of the very first rap records ever. And I was, you know, privy to hear these records. And it kind of got me into it. Fatback, don't you hesitate, you know, and everybody wanted to learn Sugar Hill lyrics, all that stuff.
Yeah.
So I just kind of stuck with it on through junior high school and stuff, where kids were like, you know, reciting Dolomite rhymes. I was reciting my own rhymes in cypher. And then by the time I started going to high school, there were other kids, and hip hop was well established by then. And I just stayed with it, battling and getting crews and shit.
So yeah, what was your first like recording experience like? Because I mean, you definitely talking pioneer level. You know, you talking about, you know, getting fresh.
So, yeah, this circa like 81 when I first started rapping.
Okay.
Yeah, and then recording-wise, some of my first demos I did with my homeboy DJ Punish.
Okay.
And I might have been about, I want to say 13 or 14. Dope. 14 maybe. Wow. 13, 14, start recording. And we didn't have a microphone. We didn't have a microphone, but he had like a dual cassette situation, and I would rap in the headphones. And he would plug the headphones in the mic jack. And then I would rap over like other instrumentals, like, you know, just jazz records, get his mom's records, rest in peace, and rap over those, or I rap over ska records, you know, specials and all that. Or I was rapping over like kind of like new wave music too. I think I did something over Shout, let it all out, all that stuff.
But it's crazy because the stuff that you rapping over, obviously people started sampling later in the day to make hip-hop records, but there was no hip-hop beats back then to even rap over. So you was just, because I didn't, you know, I'm younger, you know, I'm only 30. I didn't get my start to the Wu-Tang era. But, you know, you could get a record with an instrumental on there and rap over that. And you just talk about rapping over different genres of music. And that's crazy, man. That's crazy.
Originally, yeah, you went by microphone mic in the 80s.
Some of those early recordings, I think, are posted on YouTube. Somebody found them and posted them.
Wow. Nice.
And your tiny squeaky voice. And I was going in back then. Like rhyming and spoken word and different aspects of style.
Nice.
So yeah, I did some of my first demos with DJ Pun and DJ Plato, and then shortly after, I clicked with Ace and stuff, and I'll record with Spoon. We had a group called MC Aces, and so we'd beat like on the laundry room, the washing machine, you know, and record ourselves with the boombox, right? And then we would have two boomboxes so we could multi-track, but we knew how to turn the wattage down on the box, because after a couple of generations of recording yourself and doing your background, it starts to speed up and sound like a chipmunk.
Yeah.
But we had to turn down the wattage so that the actual spool of the cassette tape would spin a little slower to offset that effect. And we would record like that. And then I think one of our first times really recording in the studio, I believe, might have been some of the stuff I was recording. Well, I was writing raps for people. I wrote rap for this group, Rappenstein, and that ended up being on the first NWA album. Okay. So whatever their studios were, I remember recording in there. I remember going into another studio with AC and them doing those gothic kind of battle songs. We're throwing down! You know that.
Nice.
But what I said, gushing gore is what you're in for. You should have, could have, would have had a hideous sore. The mark of a very desperate desperado. Like all that kind of stuff.
Nice.
What was it like being in the West Coast hip-hop scene in the early 90s? What was that like?
Yep. So this is mid-80s. I'm talking about little recordings and shit. Jesse Jackson, when he ran for president. Antron. And that song was called Go Jesse Go, and they played it on the radio, and I did a few shows, and I performed out here in LA at the Shrine. I was just a kid, but I met Jesse Jackson and his son at the time. It was funny. Then toward the late 80s, I did a couple recordings and stuff. I did a lot of demos, like one of the first R&B rap joints, like right after Melly Mel and Chaka Khan and all of that. It was with this lady, Carmen Carter, for Arista Records, and it was different versions of that. I did a remix for the Wailers, Bob Marley's Wailers, a song called A Friend. And it's kind of like a rap Cockney thing. I did like 89, 90. And then by that time, we started recording To Whom It May Concern as the Freestyle Fellowship.
Okay. It sounded like your whole career, you just had your own thing going the whole time. Like you weren't, because you're not talking about signing with no labels, really like that, or commercial.
But no, we're definitely independent.
Yeah.
Early on, and then people wanted to get signed, and it was, you know, you deal with all the little people trying to push their line and their agenda. Then, you know, we finally get our independent thing out in this role, and then we end up getting signed to 4th and Broadway. Okay. Same label Mob Deep and was on, Island 4th and Broadway. The solo deal was a trip because I did a record, but it didn't come out. Because you know my style and how I get down, you know, rap, singing, and all of that. And at the time, the label wasn't quite ready for that because it didn't sound like anything on the radio, you know, the way I would shadow and match what the music tones are. But through the years, all the different styles, you know, proven to be marketable. So after the Fellowship second record, I did a record, but it didn't come out. But it was dope. Some of them songs ended up coming out later on my album, Timetable. And then on through, you know, I was working on another solo record, and I put out a couple of singles. Then we did Haikudata, mid-late 90s, and then I did another solo record, It's All Love. So my record sustaining is Myka 9, It's Fellowship. We have, first for Fellowship, we have To Whom It May Concern, Any City Griots, Shaka Doom, 98 Sessions, Promise, Power Plant, and Temptations. So those are the different Fellowship albums. And then Haiku d'Etat had two albums.
Yeah.
One was Haiku d'Etat, self-entitled, and the other one was Coup d'Etat Trek.
I grew up on Inner City Grind. I mean, that stuff were great. That was my childhood, listening to that stuff.
Pretty progressive record. We stretched out. I did Park Bench People. It was kind of singing. People credit that as being one of the first neo-soul records. They credit that would be one of the first neo-soul records. Of course, we're, you know, butchering and chopping all over it.
Yeah.
I like Pieces song, Six Tray, because it's like multiple, like different time signatures on it, and he's chopping it.
That's one bouncing, of my favorite,
you know, tracks, like trap, like trap before trap. And then of course that song Mary, and people think that, you know, Bone Thugs and them kind of bit Mary or whatever. I ain't tripping, you know what I mean? Like, people just do what they do, you know.
That Life Death track you did with Profuse 73 was amazing. How'd you hook up with Profuse, and what was it like working together?
Oh man, he's incredible, man. And it was pretty simple because he already had the vocals. He just went to do the track. So he just basically did his track to the vocals, and he fucking butchered it, man. I love it.
Yeah.
So ahead of his time, you know, because you have rap in and of itself as a form of hip hop that gelled with disco funk music early on and jazz. It kind of morphed in with the industrial new wave and obviously electro. There's always been some kind of a rap thing going on, mixing up with the dancehall, you know, from like, I don't know, say early 80s, you know, from like So Sonic Force and all that kind of stuff, where just rappers are rap on that, to the early 90s when, you know, jungle music started coming up and drum and bass rapping on that.
Like, what are your thoughts on like the East Coast that was coming up? Because I'm from the Midwest, right? So, you know, what I had back in the day, you know, Psychodrama and Twista and Bone Thugs.
Bone Thugs was the shit. Because I heard they demos. I used to be friends with Easy, rest in peace.
Okay.
Yeah. He was like, should I sign him? And I was like, yeah, you should sign him. What the fuck's on? Because the homie was producing him, this guy named Tim. I think he went by the name of DJ Unique. And he's cool as fuck. And I was like, yeah, put them on. Let them get on, do their shit. And in my mind, I'm thinking, they sound a little like us too. You know, hey, keep them doors open. You know, let's make this a move.
But what about cats like the Jungle Brothers?
But real quick, when you said Midwest,
Twista. Because I'm from
Twista, I remember rapping with him way back in the day, just in the streets.
Okay.
Can't remember if we battled or not. I think we were cool, more like allies.
Yeah.
He spent time in L.A. He used to call himself Tongue Twister back then. I remember Tech N9ne before he blew up too. He'd just be like over at Fat Jack studio somewhere. Shout out DJ Fat Jack from ATU. Shout out Abstract Root. And he would just be sitting in the corner just writing his rhymes, you know, getting all his ammunition together. And he blew the fuck up.
I mean, Project Blood is an historic part of West Coast hip-hop. A lot of cats known today, like Bone Thugs and Harmony and Ice Cube, went to that Goodlife Cafe, which later spawned the careers of groups like Jurassic 5. How did you hear about the Goodlife Cafe?
The Goodlife Cafe was brought to my attention, I like to say, by AC Alone and Juke. Hey, man, there's an open mic spot where we can bust that they just opened up down the street.
Okay.
And then they knew Rib and CBNM and B-Hawg, shout out Arcane Blaze. I went down to the place. And I was like, there's nobody here. Because what I've been doing was I would like, you know, I would go to New York almost every summer, every other year, since like 85. I just spend my summers out there and rap and stuff. So by a while, I started getting brave with my mic after doing enough battles and pep rallies.
Yep.
Pep rallies, talent shows, and I also had drama. So what I started to do as a kid, I started drinking coffee, man. I was like 17, 18, and it took me a while to kick coffee, but I used to go to coffee houses. There was a resurgent coffee house scene like the early Jack Kerouac, Allen Ginsberg days in New York. So in the East Coast, there were coffee houses I would go to because they would have an open mic. Mm-hmm. And on the West Coast, you know, places like Highland Grounds and stuff like that, they had open mic and poetry workshops. Like in New York, it might have been Bob Hope's Mouth Almighty. And then out here, it might have been stuff that like Macy Gray and them used to do. But by any rate, in the late 80s, I would go to coffee houses and just get on the open mic, but instead of doing a little poetry, I would just say my raps a cappella. And I started making a name for myself. But after a while, though, you know, the coffee was starting to get to me. So they said, oh, there's a vegetarian, vegan, Goodlife cafe. So I'm like, wow, this is different. And then I went there and there was nobody there. And so me, Jupiter, and AC set up some chairs on their little micro stage they had. And we just, you know, started giving style exhibitions and rhyming and coming to the place with little beats that they could play on cassette tape.
So y'all,
and by this time, I think only two people might have been there. Might have been Riddler or a couple cats. So then the first week we went, nobody was there, just the people that worked there. The second week we went, maybe four people came. You know, the next week, so it was every Thursday. 10 people. Then the next week, you know, when I always tried to come with a different song or a different flow that I write, memorize, some kind of antic or whatever, rapping over beats like, but anyway, then after a week or two, you start seeing 40 people, 50 people, and it started exponentially increase. And we would have fun at the Good Life, man. You know, I would like sit down on the stage and just play a drum and rap at the same time, or like rap over stuff like Mo Better Blues that you know, like just antics. And then all the other artists started to show up in there. And I remember the early days, the early CBE hip hop plans.
Yeah.
Two mixes, J5, Dress Spot, and Visitor Cruise, because by this time you start to bubble Lyricist Lounge in New York. And they were bubbling out in Pasadena, dropping Science. Shout out Zoza. So people started to bounce from different places. You know, you catch Black Eyed Peas performing there. You catch Volume 10 performing there in Good Life, you know, because he was more mainstay. He was part of heavyweights anyway. Shout out Volume 10. But I mean, so many artists, you know, Bichul, I mean, there's just countless artists from the Good Life chronicled in Ava DuVernay's movie, This Is the Life. And she was an excellent MC as well. Her and Giant and their group Figures of Speech. But no, different groups came. You had Ahmad, Jamal. Back in the day when I was young, I'm not a kid anymore. He was a regular at the Good Life. And he went up and started 4th Avenue Jones. Who else was regular there? I would see, Skilo. I wish I was a little bit taller. I wish I was a baller, you know. Obviously, Jurassic 5, you know, heralded right. Worldwide.
Probably like Pitch as well.
Or whatever. There were some bigger names because I remember Ice Cube bringing the Lynch Mob over there. And that's when he started coming with the boom, ping, pings and all of that. I remember, you know, we used to rap with, because I used to write rhymes for RBX, right? And do music with RBX. Just, you know, because back then everybody was secure. You could write rhyme for me, I'll write rhyme for you. Ain't no big deal. Doesn't take anything away from his skill or my skill or anything. It's just, we was all filling each other's shit. And I went to pick him up in Long Beach, and I said, man, I need some weed. And he was like, let me go around the corner and get some weed for my little cousin. He was like, come with me. And that's where I met Snoop. And he was just ironing some khakis. Hey, man, I got some raps. I got some raps. He just had some raps in the dream back then.
Snoop, yeah, man.
He had a nice little fluffy satchel, too, and some endo. You know, we called it endo back then. It wasn't Kush. It wasn't Chronic. So anyway, that's why we all started hanging out and shit. He come to Good Life and bust with us sometime. And I remember battling Corrupt and shit. And, getting to know these guys and, you know, garnering that mutual respect. So by the time we started getting our record deals and, you know, we in the studio, rehearsal studio, trying to work on our fellowship formula, we would also, at least me and Peace, would also go down there and fuck with Dr. Dre and fuck with them. Because I've been knowing Dre since I wrote those early songs for N.W.A., I mean, that group Rappenstein. So back in the early, you know, late 80s, you know, going to the Rhodium Swap Meet and all that stuff, like 85, 86, I knew him, been knowing Easy. And, you know, I met Warren G, because he's related to Dre. But by any rate, we go over to their studio and they're formulating their formula, but that wasn't Death Row yet. That wasn't even, they didn't click up like that.
Well, just, that was pre-Death Row.
You know? That was, yeah, pre-Chronic. And it was just their talent pool on their end. And so then by the time they put together, you know, the Death Row and the Chronic and shit, they had a jacket for me and for Peace and had our gold chains. But we had already clicked up the Freestyle Fellowship. And we like, you know, at that time thinking we all gonna do it.
It's
you know
a different type of energy though, too. I don't know, you know what I'm saying? I don't you
no
know
doubt
what
they it's a different
with Death Row. And, I don't know.
Shug, all that shit too, but it did have a little bit of a kind of a gangster thing. And you know,
yeah.
We were getting more into our consciousness back then after being at the Good Life and Freestyle Fellowship. We wanted to set a different we wanted to set ourselves apart from that. We kind of thought, well, NWA already did that, so you know, whatever. you know, it didn't stop though.
Let's talk about freestyle. Huh? Let's talk about freestyle.
Sure, so, talk about anything under the sun. What's up?
I love freestyling. Freestyling for me, I feel like it's a form of telepathic communication with higher beings. Like there is a way to become a channel. You never know what you're going to flow next. And I love that. Mm-hmm. And Freestyle Fellowship. I was researching freestyle as far as like what the documents are historically that have been written about that. Because, you know, we did an episode on what actually freestyle is and the history of that. And previously, freestyle was basically talking about free of style, not necessarily having a theme when you're writing a rap. Then later, that became more coined towards off the top rhymes. And in fact, you're attributed to being one of the people that coined the phrase freestyle in reference to making up raps on the spot.
Yeah, we thought it was better to fully define or redefine in the rap arena, you know, what freestyling was. Because like I said, I'd be going to New York, and they would say like freestyle or wild style, and that was just rapping on the spot, or rapping without rapping about a certain subject. But most of the time, it was written or precogged or memory raps that I found myself in the ciphers. Not too many, if any, were really sky rapping. You know, in New York, they called it sky rapping a little bit. And then mutually, it was like come off the top of the dome kind of thing, right? Mm-hmm. But then there were so many different ways for people like back then, bus or flex or spit. To this day, it's different things, but there was nothing definitive for improvisational rap or spontaneous rap. And so, you know, being a skater back then and stuff, you know, there was like freestyling, you know, and then you hear maybe a Rakim, you know, back then mentioned a Fearified freestyle. Karis One would mention cruising down the street on my freestyle fix, which was like a bike, you know what I mean? A fixie. Just pulling it all together. And I was just like, it's like a freestyle floor exercise in gymnastics or something. You know, we're actually freestyling. So that's what I was like.
I related it to a lot is with the improvisation that you get in jazz. And obviously, you're definitely.
Yeah, my parents were jazz musicians and stuff, musicians of sorts.
Like, you like a lot of people ain't into jazz because it's like that, where it's kind of free form, it's all over the place. Like sometimes the jazz musicians, when they was making the stuff, they didn't know what they was making until they made it. And you know, that's like when you hear each jazz record, that's why it's so unique, depending on the artist. It's going into era like soul, where you get somebody like James Brown, scatting, a lot of shouting, yelling. That's kind of, to me, I think that was like the early forms of what, you know, what the, like you say, the sky rapping or off the top.
Because freestyling back then would help not only when you're battling and you run out of rhymes or you can't remember your rhyme, but it also helped you extend your rhyme ammunition, because you could bust something written or bust something you memorized, then bust some freestyles in a couple of rounds and then go back to other things written. Sometimes you find yourself winning battles just because this or that cat didn't even have enough rhymes. He like just didn't have any more. He ran out of gas.
Yeah. So I absolutely love Park Bench People. It's one of my most favorite tracks, and it's definitely got some jazziness feel to that. And it's also said that to be a good hip-hop artist, you need to use your voice as an instrument on the track. Do you have any tips for hip-hop artists that are coming up trying to make their voice as an instrument on the track? Because you're very good at that.
I think just the musical sensibility that I learned through the years, you know, like I played trumpet a little bit too, you know, and produced a little bit back in the day, and I used to try to break dance. I used to try to graffiti art and, you know, stuff. But I think all those different things I tried made me a better MC, and I bring that to bear. But as an instrumentalist, and thinking of rap as an instrument, you know, like you got your syllables, consonants, vowels. But just studying music or having some kind of sense of music theory, a lot of the times it helps, you know, when you're arranging songs and composing songs, or if you're trying to match a certain cohesive tone musically, like. But in hip-hop, there's no rules. Like, I've heard people rap hardcore on soft beats. And I've heard people diss people, but rapping more sentimentally soft and psychological. But so far as instrumentation goes, I would always advise rappers to listen to the bass, whatever the low line is in the track, and, you know, hear where the kick and the snares are at, you know, and see if you can kind of lock in with that a little bit before you stretch out. You know, so it's always good to establish a foundation of knowing where you're at. Because when I discovered these things, I started to geek out. When I found out later, because I used to love, like, I still love Ultramagnetic, for example. I thought I was the only one that was matching verse patterns in the 80s. But they were doing that too, and Diverse Vernacular. Cool Keefa opened up a verse on the first part of the song, but then you'll catch two or three verses later, Set G on the tail end of the song, opening up his verse with the same cadence that Cool Keef used, but putting in different words. I thought that was brilliant. Another thing I used to geek off of after a while was when syllables would fall on the beat, not in necessarily the block style, but that was one of the main reasons why I used to love Fife and Q-Tip in them, because we realized they're locking in their lyrics with the kick and snare and the rhythm of the beat solidly, almost deliberately. Or De La Soul, when they started running patterns and matching patterns, all three of them keeping that same pattern, or Stetsasonic, matching patterns with three different MCs. Rest in peace, Fuquan. I used to just lose it. And then, of course, we know rapid fire delivering, chopping, because I've been chopping since like 86, right? I made the little chop style up. People used to think that shit was whack, but I said, I'm going to stick to it. I liked it. Mix the dance hall with the jazz and just kind of go for it. And that was going to be my thing too.
Music theory and understanding the register and the range of how music works is going to help rappers as well find that melody, find that rhythm in between just the kick and the snare as well to weave in and out. So,
And then we start rapid fire delivery. We're all over the place, wild styles and stuff. And then it's just different tools in the box. You can bring that to bear when you're trying to make an impression, you know, in the rap arena.
Let's touch on a rather difficult topic.
If you want to touch on it.
It's something right now that has caught the attention of a lot of folks. Talib Kweli's been sending out shots fired left and right now. He's saying that he's mad that after he felt Rifleman dissed him, that because you didn't stand up and take his side, he had to start dissing you. And so we're curious what was going on there, what you're feeling about it, and just some background.
Basically, you know, me and Talib go back. And me and L.A. Cool go back a little further. And, you know, crew is crew like that. I think Talib got triggered by a troll that mentioned L.A. Cool. And I guess Talib forgot meeting L.A. Cool, because, you know, L.A. Cool is Rifleman, so that can be confusing because he got two names. Dude was like, you know, going at it with this troll dude. And, you know, as Talib grew up, I noticed that he has a lot of those kind of altercations and whatnot with people. The dude had said something about you didn't want no smoke with Rifleman, something that I guess happened 15, 20 years ago. I never knew about it. L.A. Cool never told me.
Something about his
chick or some chick, he like gave him a flyer. Or he gave her a flyer, probably one of our Project Blowdown anniversary or something. And she just like took him and threw it down or something. And then he threw the flyer and it hit her or something. And then Talib was going to try to run up on him or something and didn't want no smoke or something. I don't know, some stuff. But Talib wasn't having it. And the dude started atting L.A. Cool. And he was like, I don't give a fuck who this is, that is. And L.A. Cool was at first because he real feisty. L.A. Cool was like, oh, man, I'm not tripping, man. I got respect for you. You know, I ain't trying to, you know, escalate this dumb shit or whatever, you know, storm me out. Like, basically, bow down. You know, not bow down, but like, you know, was trying to be peaceful.
Yeah, make the peace.
But then Talib and that dude still kept atting him. And then he started getting molded. You know, dumb shit started happening. Like, while they going at it, I'm at my bro Ross G, rest in peace, his memorial. Cool not want to back down, you know, and he'd just been dealing with some stuff too. And so I tried to poly it out with these guys. You know, talk on the phone or let's arrange a meeting or something. But by then, there was too much trash talk. And with the trolls involved, it just started to go other level with all kind of accusations and things and just dragging it. You know, they dragging me by this time. They dragging me and my name. So this is what happened. Look, I said, I think it's shortly after Nipsey died. I said, in the spirit of Nipsey Hustle, you know, let's keep it peace. I love both of y'all, you know. And I posted the Black Man's Oath, you know, which I promised not to hurt, harm, or anything like that type of deal, right? But they wasn't having the meeting. They wasn't having the thing. And Talib on the low was like, I know he's already changing the narrative because you already said it. But either way, even though he says it, still sound like some bitch-ass shit because it's all love off the dribble, right? But then, nigga, how you going to tell me if I don't publicly shame L.A. Cool and denounce him or whatever, you going to start dragging my name? And mind you, this is a nigga with $1 million and 1 million followers.
Yeah.
Trying to dunk my bro who just almost lost his life because Cool got shot like 3-4 times in the neck and arm and body and shit. But then, man, I'm thinking, man, I'm 50 some years old, however old I was a couple years ago. I'm like, I'm just trying to cruise. Dig, and I mean, Talib's gonna be friends for life. That's my guy, my guy. We started talking privately.
Get in between, man.
And I was like, I'm not gonna let you drag me into this dark vortex, bro. You know, y'all need to knock this shit off. Because Cool wasn't tripping on me. He wasn't like, oh, your homie's a bitch, fuck you, you know, whatever. He wasn't asking me to publicly save Talib. None of that shit. And that's like the hubris of it all.
Yeah.
So I refused, you know, and then Talib started dragging me. Then he was dragging LA Cool so much. Cool did a diss song and a diss video. Then Talib was talking more shit or something at a show or something. Cool did another diss song and a diss video. And by that time, because they was dragging me, I did a subliminal kind of diss song.
Okay.
And it's called Fairweather Friend. And but, you know, I still wasn't calling out names, you know, trying to keep it out of the public arena, but just basically venting feelings. Only he would know what I'm talking about.
I think we actually had an episode just talking about
rap beefs
and stuff like that. But just like the importance of keeping it on wax.
And if y'all hip hop, put it on wax or something.
Well,
and Nick kept saying, oh, it's more than rap. It's more than rap. Like, well, what else is it going to be, bro?
So
let me finish real quick. So
yeah.
After that, I guess last year in February or something, I didn't notice, but I guess Talib went in the studio with Diamond D and did a diss song. You know, he might have 20 diss songs. I don't know. And but it started to slow down a little bit, like last year, whatever, the Rona and everything else. But occasionally, every couple months, something he'll kick up, and a lot of his fans were at me, give me, you know, because at first when it kicked off, a lot of people were at me and give me death threats and shit. And then as things, but more people started hitting me up when they did their own research and started having my back.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, he's trashing me on Facebook, trashing me here, trashing me that, whatever.
On Instagram.
And it's backfiring on him when I read the comments. So then he does the song with Diamond D, you know, and all right, you know, whatever, you know what I mean? I know Talib's skills. He could have did better, but, you know, that was what he did. And not only did he drag me and Cuba, now he's dragging my crew, you know, Fellowship. And I remember some of the early tweets about Project Blow's trash and all this is trash, you know? Mm-hmm. So you're dissing Project Blow, you're dissing Fellowship, you're dissing me. Come on, man. Then, a couple months ago, I guess, he put out a video and got my image and taking my face and fucking my face up and all that shit. And I'm like, damn, well, you know, I thought your shit was really cool, whatever, but you really dragging me and really sticking to that narrative. And so I was just like, all right, well, fuck it. So I still was just praying on it, just meditating on it. And I was like, man, you know what? Fuck this nigga, man. I got to diss this nigga. And so I got nails for that box, bro, as we speak. And me and Cool got some shit together as we speak. That's going to be released any day now.
Okay.
And it's already going up. I'm already getting more fans, getting more show offers, getting more features offers. So thank you, Talib. Shit, nigga.
Well, and so.
And, you know, I can sit down with anybody. Don't get me wrong. I'll sit down with somebody, but I would say just a public apology is necessary. It's one of the preconditions. Well, and but either way, I got to level up. Yeah. I got to level up. So I got to drop my shit.
Yeah. Well, you gotta respond, you know, at some point after all these years. And so what gets me about this is that Talib, you mentored Talib, right? I mean, he actually learned skill sets from you.
I don't give a motherfucking fuck with him. Yeah, when he was young, I met him like 17 or something. I was 17. 19 or something. And, you know, he rhymed and told me, he said, yeah, you rap a little better, you know, since you've been hanging out with Michael. Most people do, you know what I mean? Because, you know, this ain't just about freestyling. It's like being open, getting open, and having a dynamic range. And I'm a curated style and do some demos and shit. And he started doing demos with me and some other cat around the corner. And I met him through this cat named Omari in Bed-Stuy, and, you know, Mood, Dante, and Main Flow shot them out. You know, through all them, that's how it's kind of like Talib started going to Natty and, you know, met Tech. And then, you know, we used to hang out, though. It'd be like me, him, this cat Forte, producer, Fuji's and shit, Lauren Hill, Yasi Bay, or Dante, Most Def, I mean, Prodigal Son, Aaron Juju, Divine, Makiba. You know, we had like a cool little crew, you know, kicking with Nat back then too. Super Nat Muhammad, who ended up changing his name to Phoenix Orion, was around there. And you know, we're parking. So he's going to the park, going to the clubs, just going around doing shit. I had a record deal. So, you know, we had a little money and shit. And have my little studio shit and wait for places in between places, actually stay with Talib. He stayed with me for a minute. So you had that. As Blue and D and Anthony Marshall and them were formulating not only Lyricist Lounge, but, you know, the other cats later, they joined in, like them to do Raucous Records and all that shit. So, but I had already been coming back to L.A. The trip is when you see the narrative switch and when you understand, like, you got your faith in yourself and what you do, you're going to start to stay with it. Because I didn't know what was going to happen. I still don't know what's going to happen. You know, when you get threats, people, you know, saying this and that and changing the narrative, trying to take it someplace where it don't belong. I think, like you said earlier, it's cool to just keep it with hip hop and keep it hip hop. That's the best way to do it.
What I'm curious is what conflict is rumor and what is BS? Because, so, you know, Tumex made that Instagram video, had probably 100 comments on there. I was on there as well.
Talk about his diss records. That's nothing. You know, fucked up if you got Tumex dissing you. You're fucked up somewhere.
Yeah. And so I was on there inviting both of you guys onto the podcast, and Talib, obviously, he was like, no, not unless, you know, Myka 9 recants.
Yeah, he did that shit. He told DJ Bonds in a documentary, LA Cool is in a documentary, I don't want to be in a documentary, you know, just like overboard, off code, goofy boy fuckery. I can't believe it.
People were saying that Talib Kweli had hired some kind of right wing squad to put threats on, I guess, someone's life, Rifleman's life, or something. Is that true? Did that happen?
I don't know if he did it. But yeah, niggas, no, I mean, I get death threats all the time because I'm an MC and there's a lot of weirdo fans up here, but not that many, but every now and then you'll get them. Comes with territory. But yeah, he was like dragging niggas into some other shit that had nothing to do with us. Talking about some racist shit and misogyny and some dumb shit and like, nobody on that, you know, and then just watching his moves, dissing adults, you know, was it African descendants of slaves? Just this whole thing down is kind of, it's really a trip when I started looking at it outside of the friend lens and just looking at what kind of nigga this is.
Yeah,
I'm like, something, he made a wrong turn somewhere. Maybe it's just a narcissist hubris or something, but you made a wrong turn somewhere, bro, you know. Something ain't right, because it ain't just me. It's like you funk with a lot of people. And it ain't like weak individuals, just, you know, strong-minded people, people that have good hearts and things of that nature, and, you know. Because I always had Talib back, dig, like, especially in the internet arena, you know, I'd be like, I don't give a fuck what this is, that I'm riding with Talib. Yeah. You know, because that's my bro. He's still my bro, you know what I mean? I'm sending him love. I'm sending him love right now. You know, but after you did that shit, nigga, all right. I'm trying to stay above the fray, you know, it's all love.
Yeah.
But at this point, I guarantee you I got nails for that box.
So I've met Talib Kweli in person at South by Southwest, and we broke it up over, you know, kind of his, right before his album Gutter Rainbows came out, he actually told me ahead of time before it was even public, because I happened to catch him on 6th Street during South by 1 year, and we had this conversation, and we built about kind of my history of growing up living on the streets in a cardboard box and how I got into
this shit was hip-hop. Hard, huh?
Yeah. How I got into hip-hop as a result of that and finding a community in hip-hop when my blood relatives, you know, I wasn't really chilling with them at all. And so, and he was cool in person and it was dope. But there are different sides to everyone. And you know, you guys have a shared history. He's going through something right now and he's putting it on you and Rifleman, and then the whole project blowed. So if Talib Kweli was here right now, what would you say to him?
I got nails for that box. I'm only talking about lyrics, nigga. Don't be trying to take it out me. Out us killing. Don't try to take it out of us killing you off with that microphone business and all that. One wrong thing leads to another wrong thing, nigga. One good thing leads to another good thing, nigga. And I still got love for you, you know. I ain't gonna sit down until there's a worldwide apology to me and my crew. But I still gotta clap back. I gotta level up, nigga. Cause you did that. And I'ma tell another grown motherfucker what to do or what not to do. I'm telling LA Cool to pipe down, nigga, after you came at him, you know, talking about he got shot and all that wild shit. And at the same time, I'm going to tell Talib to chill out if niggas is talking about his personal business and shit and all of that too. You dig? And, you know, individuals are going to bring what tools they have to, you know, bring what power they have to bear. But I would honestly say peace is better than war. And if you got love in your heart, you're sending somebody love, picturing love coming back, you're not going to make them kind of choices. And finally, a man of his status and stature and platforms to try to assassinate my character and dunk my career and diss my crew, which is not crew like a normal crew. Like, this L.A. Underground, this legacy, bro. You know, this the shit that inspired you, bro. And I don't know, man. It just seemed like he was more the aggro and more of the antagonizer in this situation tremendously. And he has his rights as anybody does to defend themselves. However, peace is better than war.
Yeah, all in all,
I don't know why motherfucker think he's gonna diss me and diss my name and I ain't gonna do nothing. I'm for Project Blow. I'm a good lifer, nigga. I'm a good lifer. I'm a fellowshipper, bro. For real, for real.
Louisian.
He gonna get this work, watch.
Well, I'm excited to see what you and Rifleman come up with.
Well, one of my songs will be done tonight, nigga.
Nice. Okay.
He said he in the studio.
And it is right so now. Scary, bro. Well, it's so scary, right? But I'm like, YouTube. I ain't gonna diss nobody. I'm not gonna diss nobody unless they diss me.
Yeah.
I never thought my wildest dreams Talib would diss me. That's nigga's crazy. My bread and butter. That's my bro. I still got love for him, no doubt, but I never thought my wildest dreams.
That would be the one, huh?
Man.
That's crazy.
You know, whoa. And thank you. Thank you. I'm laughing to the back. Thank you. And, you know, if it makes his career a little more relevant in the underground or whatever the case may be, hey, maybe there's something mutually beneficial in the arrangement. But niggas already killed him off lyrically. Now we're just going to, you know, he's going to get coffinized. He's getting coffinized, I'm telling you. We're just keeping it like that. Ain't like nobody gonna fire on him. Nobody trying to chunk him, get no weird shit. And I hope none of his weirdo fans, whatever weirdo fans is out there listening, don't come at us like we're against the Black Revolution or that's all bullshit, bro. Keep this shit hip hop. They were trash talking. Keep it hip hop. Niggas really need to piece that shit out, you know, and show the fans, you know, that we can have some Black unity out here. It's enough people beefing and. Some people be taking that shit too far and all that wild shit, and they ain't got no self-control. And I know sometimes, you know, absolute power absolutely corrupts, right?
I feel you. I've been in fights because I won a freestyle battle, and they couldn't handle it, and so they got physical with it.
Bro, for real?
Yeah.
Me too.
For real.
Me too. When niggas put guns out on me, all that shit. For real.
Yeah. People got to keep it to the
head. But ain't funny?
Just get better.
Serve a nigga. Look. You serve a nigga, and then you beat the brakes off him.
You like you ain't gonna win no way, bro. You ain't have nah. I feel you on that. You like, bro. You don't want these words.
You serve a nigga, then you run the play. You line it up, and it's like, damn, I served you, and I beat you up.
Listen,
I remember I served this one fool, and his DJ was DJ Hamburger Man. This is a funny story. I'm going to the warehouse, right?
DJ Hamburger.
And I'm serving this nigga. I forgot, what was his name? Funky Fresh, somebody like that. And I just served him, right? So I'm in there at the warehouse. It's a record store off of the Brand Rodeo, right? And LL is coming in. So I'm the first in line. I want to, you know, meet LL and get him to sign my record. You know what I mean? But in my mind, I'm like, I'm going to battle LL as soon as I get to the front of the line. Right? So I just served this fool. And then I'm in there. You know, back in these days, back in the 80s days or the 90s, late 80s, you know, it was all the battling going on in hip-hop. You dig? Just in the streets, people would just do that. And it would take, you know, it was, you snatch somebody's soul. When you serve somebody, sometimes they didn't rap no more. So I served this fool. And then this dude, big old Mr. Hamburger Man, DJ on the radio with his Jerry Curl and shit. Oh, I got a homie that'll serve you. And I was like, Oh, that dude, no, I already melted him. You know, he already done business. And I had some girls around me, so he's trying to show up for the girls. He just tried to fire on me. And then security guards kicked us out, right? Basically, he fired on me. He was kind of a bigger dude. And before I could get to him, he said, you know, the security guards broke us up. So we outside. And I'm telling the homies, yo, this big fool tried to fire on me. You know what I mean? I'm trying to get my ducks in a row. You know, it's about to kick off. I don't know who he up here with. I turn around, bow! He ran right up on me. Bow! Sucked the fuck out of me. I didn't even see him coming. So then it's on. Rah, 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 I'm rattling. Then he picked me up. And I can see the whole crowd waiting for LL. Mind you, this is in front of the door. And he does the best thing, and body slams my little ass. Oh, boom. And I'm just on my back cracking. It just sounded off. After that point, I was like, all bets are off. I let my hands go. I melted this thing and pulled him by his jerry curl. Had his racking his head all up in the bike rack right in front so he couldn't get out. So it's just like, melt, melt, melt. Then this fool got up one time again and pulled out a 22. And what was funny was while I'm chucking him with him, he drops the gun. And one of the lady security guards picks up the gun. And I'm like, damn, you just going to kill me, nigga? I really fucked this nigga up to where I beat him up into the doors, the glass doors. They just opened it real quick for him because they didn't want to let nobody in yet. The Mania LL, right? And I see LL over there getting ready to sign some stuff sitting at the desk. And then all you see is this dude face in the window. This dude face in the window. He's falling in the window. So they drag him in the glass door. Then he's looking at me, but it's like blood all on the window. And what was funny, I was boxing with him and I had on shell toes and fat straps. So my shoes came off. And somebody stole my shoes. I had to walk back to AC alum came and brought me some more shoes. I had to walk to the laundromat. I was so embarrassed. Oh, you know, man. But I still had my Kango. I still had my BBDs. I still had my Lees. I was fresh.
Yeah.
Still got a chance to meet LL, all that shit.
Did you get your record signed that day? Did you? Or did you?
No. AC got one signed for me, I think, or somebody. Because it was kind of pear-shaped at that point.
That was a rough day.
But fights over fucking hip-hop. Crazy yeah, brawls. Yeah, like, yes. Back in the 84, 85, they had some shit called LA Street Scene. Mm-hmm. And, you know, gothic battles back then. Woo! My guy Herb Dean, the referee for MMA fights and shit. Black dude with the locks. Mm-hmm. He still remembers some of my old raps from back then. He'll see me. He'll be like, "I'm soaring through the air like a bird in flight." That's right. He remembers my shit. I'm bringing him up because niggas used to fight with the punk rockers.
Mike and I just want to say, you know, I really appreciate you speaking with us on Front of the Jump.
Man.
Much respect, much props.
It's so, all love.
So it is all love. It's one love. And so I wanted to ask you, and we want to be respectful of copyright. So we actually had Slug give the okay from Atmosphere to use one of the songs off Overcast when we interviewed Spawn, one of the co-founders of Atmosphere back in the day.
I love those guys.
Yeah, great. And so I wanted to ask you if there was a song of yours you wanted us to play as part of the podcast for the outro or a break.
I'm just thinking Delusions of Grandeur, if you're familiar with that too.
Okay, yeah, I'll put it on. Yeah, Myka, we got you, man.
Oh, yeah.
It's been a pleasure riding through this journey from the 80s to the present and talking about what's going on right now. And listen, much love, man. I wish you the very best. I think you're one of the most talented MCs out there.
Thank you.
I love the integration of the jazz rhythms that you do in your rapping. I think there are not enough MCs that have integrated jazz into hip hop, and I love jazz. So I love what you do there. And you know, you got my number. We're on Facebook. I've known you for years, so just hit me up anytime. And
all love, man. I sincerely appreciate this opportunity to clear the air on certain matters, and as well as you know, share our mutual love for hip hop and positive creativity.
Stay up, Mike and Nine. Thanks again.
It's all up. Gone. Pulpit without the bullshit. Insignificant unless you are really used to it. And discipline, give it dividends, live independent. And if any do truth fits, cruise it, produce it, move it. Delusions are granted, the fusions and efforts are pools in the mansion. The doors of the France of a movement is soothing the fans. We could music advance as a sleuth and recluse in the rants of the voodoo to anthem. You could play the tandem, mention of the fandom. From Lemonade Stand to the Renegade Plans with the Minute Maid Clan. Revolutionary rule with demands. Keep putting a haiku on my hand. You with two pieces of man, so secure for your cancer. It's a fellowship crew with the camera, a zoo. The handle is a spoof for the animals. Big biz coming through with the summon of the view for the summon of the true necromancer. But do for those hands of the extravagance of protects as a cancer for Ruby Andes. Delusions of grandeur can take over when you're not sober. Delusions of grandeur can take over when you're not sober.